Jesus as our Savior, this world is not our home. We're just pilgrims. We're passing through. And we thank God as Abraham and the other patriarchs, the word of God said, they looked for a city that had foundation, whose builder and ruler is God. So we're looking for our heavenly Jerusalem. There is a lot of fight in the Middle East, a lot of war about a small bit of land, about a city called Jerusalem. But we thank God as Christian believers, we have a hope of the heavenly Jerusalem. And we thank God in that heavenly Jerusalem, there is room for everyone. No matter what nation you're from, no matter what ethnicity, no matter what color you are, no matter what you look like, God receives us all as long as we come through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And so this morning, as we are looking and we are expecting, God wants us to occupy until His return. This is what He said to us, occupy until I come. What does that mean? Take charge on my behalf. Now when we notice in the word of God concerning the stewards that must give account to the Lord, you may ask the question, who is a steward? A steward is someone who has been entrusted with property that belongs to another person. In other words, the steward is not the owner, but the steward is taking charge on behalf of someone else. The Bible tells us that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. We see that in Psalm 24 and verse 1. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and them that dwell therein. This earth belongs to God. The word of God goes on to say He had founded it upon the floods. He had established it. The foundations of this earth was established by God. So this world belongs to Him. When we think of all the disputes about land, people like to fight over land. Most of the wars that have been fought, most of the international conflicts that we see, it's all about land. It's about possessions. But you know something? The land belongs to God. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. We are also told that the cattle on a thousand hills, that they belong to God. Everything is the Lord's. We are told also in Ezekiel that the souls belong to Him. The silver belongs to God. The gold belongs to God. We belong to the Lord. God owns us. We're not belonging to ourselves, but we are belonging to the Lord. We read there in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 20. We are told that we are bought with a price. Therefore, we should glorify God in our body and in our spirits, which belong to God. Our bodies are the temple of the living God. Now we are here in an earthly sanctuary giving praise to God. And when we enter this earthly sanctuary, we enter with a sense of reverence. We enter with a sense of holiness to praise our God. Our earthly body is the real temple of God. This is where God dwells, and we belong to Him. So we belong to God, first of all, because he created us. All things were made by him, we read in Genesis. And without him was not anything made that was made. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So all things were created by him. So he owns us by virtue of him being the creator. But secondly, he owns us by redemption. We were lost, we had gone astray, and he has redeemed us. So we are twice his. When we look back there in Genesis, at the time of creation, God gave Adam dominion over everything that he made. We see in the Psalms, it said, "What is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that thou visitest him? Because you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and with honor, and you have put all things under his feet. You have given him dominion over the beast, over the birds, the entire world." God gave man dominion. He gave man control. But he has only given us control on his behalf, because it all belongs to him. And we see in the beginning that Adam and Eve, they failed. God made a beautiful world. He placed them in it as stewards to take charge. He gave them his commandments, but they disobeyed. When God came in the cool of the day, can you imagine the privilege that Adam had? In the cool of the day, God would come down and he would have fellowship with him. He would be there. When we think of our worship this morning that we gave to the Lord, can you imagine Adam in the Garden of Eden? He had the very presence of God, the physical presence of God, worshiping. But when sin entered in, when Adam failed in his stewardship, when Eve failed, all of that was lost. Thorns and thistles, the earth was cursed. The woman was cursed, the man was cursed, the serpent was cursed. But thank God, that was not the end of it. Jesus came in the fullness of time. God sent his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to bring redemption. And the Apostle Paul said, "You who were dead in trespasses and sins, now you are made alive. Now you are resurrected in the Lord Jesus." So through Adam, the first man, man disobeyed and lost out as a steward. We see also God calling Abraham, and we see the Israelites, that they also went astray from the Lord. And so we see in Jeremiah and in Hosea that they were called to break up their fallow grounds and not to sow anymore among thorns. They were told to find the right pathway and to sow in righteousness, because God had called them out, had chosen them, had given them a responsibility. He said, "Through the seed of Abraham, all the nations of the earth would receive a blessing." But they turned from God. They turned to idols. They turned to the ways that were not the ways of God, to evil, to immorality. But the Lord called to them through the prophets, and he said, "Break up your fallow grounds, the ground that should be producing and is now run